side of the bowl. Well, you can see the sides and the sentiments. They think Gino and Chris are cute, but everybody wants Yvonne Erickson to win this match. See the situation here. Is the loser, both losers, will have their head shaved in the ring. And here they come. Gino Hernandez followed by gentleman Chris Adams. There he is, Gino Hernandez. A handsome half-breed, as he calls himself, from Highland Park.
The gentleman, Chris Adams.
Chris Adams is an addict. He's a drug addict. He's an alcoholic. He's a sex addict.
I had never done cocaine with Chris. I mean, never, ever. I barely smoked a joint with him, you know. But chop chop, you know, and I did it. I mean, they were like spelling out their names and this stuff, okay?
I watched Chris over the last year and a half of his life headed down a path that I don't think that he could have changed even if he wanted to. I honestly believe if it had not been in Bure's bedroom, it would have been someplace else.
I would just like to say that I thought Chris Adams was a great guy. Don't judge him just on his last few years because, you know, they were extreme and he did what he could to survive. But the truth is he was a really, really thoughtful person.
Of all people I've ever met in my life, he was the closest thing to Jekyll and Hyde I'd ever met. When Chris was sober, his name fitting perfect, the gentleman. When he wasn't sober, he'd been drinking, doing a few different substances, he was Hyde.
His eyes were like glowing, seemed like the Exorcist. It was a thing that you'd have to be there to see. He was wanting, I guess, out of this world.
With a great move by Chris Adams for the count of 1, 2, and 3, and Chris Adams is the champion. So it backfired. The banality of Percival Pringle III turned on him as he swung to smash Chris Adams, and instead, Chris, with a tremendous move, got that cane across the head of Rick Rude. And we have a new and exciting and popular and handsome most of the time, gentleman Chris Adams, covered with his own blood, but covered with glory, glory, at Reunion Arena in downtown Dallas, Texas.
I think his presence really enlarged the enthusiasm for world class and improved the quality of the competition. There were tremendous bouts, drawing 40,000 or more at Texas Stadium, filling the Cotton Bowl. It was an era of just unbelievable excitement, and Chris Adams was a major factor in that because of his newer and different style with his super kick and all the other things that he could do. We had the Von Erich boys, particularly Kevin and David, who were early, and then Kerry came in. And they were all tremendous athletes.
We're just about ready to go on this one. And now Chris has an announcement to make.
You listen here, Kevin Von Erich. The only difference between last year and this year is that you'll be leaving on a stretcher with a bald head this time.
When Chris Adams came in, he brought with him that assuredness of the British. He had been in Olympic trials. He'd been a champion in England.
Did it for almost 20 years before I broke into professional wrestling. So, you know, I really consider it my background, my nucleus, and the basis for everything that I've done athletically. And I believe that it's a fantastic sport.
And in fact, this is a family thing for you, isn't it, Jim?
Yeah, my brother and I started at the same time. Of course, he was younger than me, 3.5 years younger.
Too?
And my father was a judoka, so we both followed in his footsteps.
His first national.
This is when we celebrated with the bottles of lemonade?
No, that particular year, they both won the nationals.
They both won it,
in their own weights.
In their own different weights.
Yeah,
and Chris
Chris would be what?
14?
No, he wasn't that old.
No, 12?
12, yeah. 12.
One of the best times for Chris and I as we were growing up was when we were both national champions down at Crystal Palace. We both won it, and it was a great, great time. And I think he absolutely hated the fact that, you know, sometimes he wouldn't win it and sometimes he wasn't the best.
And here's the Avenger. Whoa, and the Avenger goes to work in a hurry. He has some wrestling skills. A third body slam, and the Avenger drops in on Garvin, and Garvin is undoubtedly thinking, what in the world ran into me? And Hurricane off the post. A cross kick. Hey, that looks like. Here it is. 1, 2, 3. A super kick. And the Avenger has beaten Jimmy Garvin. He's taking off his mask. He is Chris Adams. Chris Adams. Gentlemen, Chris Adams is the masked Avenger. The man who took Jimmy Garvin to a draw. The man who changed the philosophy of Garvin.
He was a trained architect, Chris was, and he got the good job. He was working for local government. He had a damn good job. He turned round one day and he said, he came in and we were just about to eat dinner, and he just said, I've got something to tell you. He said, I'm going to be a wrestler. And I
said, he'd already fixed this up, of course.
He'd already fixed it up. And he said, you'll have to watch it. He said, I'm going to be on television next week.
And he was.
And he was. And he was with all the big names like Big Daddy and Giant Haystacks.
I think the first time we ever saw him on television, you know, we had kind of mixed reactions. I mean, we were laughing, really, with him. And we wanted him, obviously, to do well with it. And I think he was pretty raw at the beginning when he started it. You know, it's pretty difficult to adapt from judo, something that is for real, to something that is show. And but he's a showman, you know. He soon learnt the game and soon learnt how to play the crowd.
The gentleman from England is hot and heavy. Now he's going. On top. Adams pummeling, fighting, battling, coming back. Now let's see if the Mongol will go flying over. And does, over the top rope, and Chris Adams has lost the bout. Well, Adams is disqualified, of course, for putting the Mongol over the top rope. But I think he has certainly a moral victory to the fan. We'll be back.
The first thing that strikes you about Chris was his appeal to women. He was like a sex god where we lived. And also, he was a lovable character.
A friend of mine really, really liked professional wrestling. And she had some tickets to go see a show. After we had watched the show, we'd gone into the bar area, and Chris gave me his telephone number and asked me to go to see the Birmingham Motor Show with him.
He'd do anything for you. Me and Chris were very close. He used to call me Dad most of the time because I was a lot older than him. But I taught him to wrestle on the lawns at the back of my house and brought him into the business.
He made the move overnight, virtually, and learned the business. And before very long, yes, he was on the top bill with Big Daddy. And
we were never too
The biggest the bill could be in this country, anyway. You know.
We were never too surprised with Chris because he'd just shoot these things at us.
Pop
all
in
of
with
a sudden,
the thing,
yeah.
And this is what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
But he would do it.
I didn't want him to go into wrestling. I just wanted him to, you know, carry on with his judo. But that was Chris. He was very determined.
I did give him my phone number and I didn't think much about it. And my mom would tell me, you know, can you please call back this guy Chris because he's ringing you off the wall.
And people stood on seats jumping up and down.
One old lady picked up a chair and threw it into the ring.
She did indeed.
Yeah, I've never forgotten that. It was fun.
And Chris loved the adulation. You know, he loved it. The fact that he was on television.
And he said, I'm going over to America. He said, I've been offered a job over there at wrestling. And he said, so we're going to move over there, which they did. And
it didn't surprise
us. It didn't surprise us at all, did it?
I think he'd got probably as far as he could get with wrestling in this country. He was looking for bigger things and he found it.
I was very sad when Chris went off to America, to be honest. But he wanted to chase his fortune. It was his dream. You know, that's what he wanted to do. And nobody would have talked him out of it. His brother or his mum and dad, they wouldn't have talked him out of it. Because one thing about Chris, he was he would go after anything. If he wanted it, he would go after it. You wouldn't stand in his way. He wouldn't listen to reason.
If he put his mind to something, that he was going to make it, he was going to be famous.
I have a lot of regrets about Chris going to America because every one of my friends that's gone to America in our profession has either come back in a box, in a wheelchair, or they've come back drug addicts.
From England, 235 pounds, the gentleman, Chris Adams.
He was a pretty face. He was a handsome, handsome guy. He had this wonderful English accent. Always loved to interview him because he always came across as more cultured than maybe the rest of us.
He had a magnetic personality. Everyone that met him liked him, really. It wasn't just the British accent. The girls loved that.
I loved Chris Adams. The second I seen him, I was like, and his accent's just like totally.
But that doesn't do it for the guys. Chris was a really good businessman. He was sharp, astute. He did his homework and didn't cut corners, and people were glad to work with him.
Nearly everybody in this film I worked with, I did things with. I'd helped create world-class championship wrestling, which skyrocketed Chris and the Von Erichs to fame. We were on in 80 stations. We were number two to Soul Train in syndication. In 23 countries, we were a top-rated show in all of Japan on Saturday night.
And Chris, being very ambitious, wanted to make more money, wanted to be a star, wanted to be at the top of the game. And so he decided, along with the wrestling gods, that he'd become a bad guy, a heel. Chris studied to be a bad guy with Gary Hart, who's great as a manager and has a tremendous background and career in wrestling himself.
He had everything that you would want in a main event wrestler. I mean, there are guys that are good and then there are guys that are great. And Chris, he was truly one of the great ones. He told me, said, I'm interested in changing my image. He said, there's not a whole lot of opportunity here with the Von Erichs because they seem to be the ones that control the main events here. And he said, I think the only way that I can go further is maybe to wrestle them.
He became great friends with the Von Erich boys, and they all worked well together, and they all really liked each other.
Into the corner, luckily here comes Kevin in. Now Chris has the chair, and he and David Manning. Kevin, drop kicking Chris. Kevin with the chair again. Now Manning is trying to stop it. Chris goes up to him, Chris.
He and someone that always liked to do business with the Von Erichs, I told Chris, hey, let's give it a go and see what happens. And Chris did exactly what I told him to do. He took direction very good. Chris, really within a matter of weeks from one of the most popular wrestlers that World Class ever had. I mean, he was on the pedestal with the Von Erichs and Bruiser Brody. I mean, people really genuinely loved Chris. And Chris asked me, he said, Gary, how are we going to make the people not like me? And all the women loved Chris. Anybody knows Chris knew women were just crazy. He was like a magnet. Chris had a habit of hugging and kissing everyone, I mean, on the way to the ring. And I told him, I said, Chris, go out on your interview and just tell the people that you're not going to kiss fat women no more. And by damn, that did it. After that, Chris Adams went from one of the most popular to probably one of the most hated wrestlers in World Class.
Are you suggesting that I told you to quit for me?
Exactly right.
You're not hot now! You're fired! Gary Hart, you're fired!
I don't believe it.
Wait a minute, Adam! Don't fire Gary Hart. You don't have the power. I promised you I would make you the American heavyweight champion, and I did well, did it. I promised you a shot at Ric Flair, and you got it. But I give you my guarantee, you ain't never gonna become no world's champion as long as I got some to do it, and you're fired.
Chris Adams reached the pinnacle of his wrestling success in the late 80s. Then there was an incident on an airplane that changed Chris's entire life.
We had a big match that was going to take place at Will Rogers Coliseum like we did every Monday night.
David Manning! I don't believe it.
And so the wrestlers were scheduled to leave San Juan on Monday morning, fly back into here, get in here plenty of time to get to the matches. And so we got the call from San Juan that the plane had lost an engine, had to go back, land. And what the airlines did, which turned out to be a big mistake, was they offered everybody on the plane free alcohol. And I'm not talking about free alcohol for 15 or 20 minutes. We're talking free alcohol for about 3 to 4 hours while they fix the plane. And the majority of the wrestlers, matter of fact, 99% of the wrestlers on the plane did not have to, they had to wrestle that night when they got back. So, you know, they had a few beers or whatever and they were done. Chris was off that night. Chris Adams did not have to wrestle in Fort Worth, so he had no reason not to keep drinking. And they supplied him with free drinks on the ground. Once they got on the plane, once again, it was open bar. And the confrontation with Chris actually came when they decided he'd had enough to drink and they tried to cut him off, no more drinking.
A stewardess cut Chris off. Do you want me to say what he told her? Okay, he says, you fucking cunt. He says, you can't fucking cut the gentleman off. He says, do you realize how much fucking money I make? And you bitch, you're gonna fucking cut me off? Well, she took off, man. She split. And she went and got a steward, you know, the guy. The guy come back and says, you're cut off. We're not gonna serve you anymore. He jumped up and said, you son of a bitch. And the guy took off running. So, you know, he hadn't touched anyone or anything. Calm down, Chris, you know. And a couple of minutes later, the co-captain of the airplane came back and he told Chris, he said, sir, he says, you might as well settle down because you're cut off and you're not getting any more drinks on this flight.
The co-pilot pointed to Chris and said, I have the power to land this plane in Miami and have you arrested. And Chris's response was,
you don't have the power.
He yanked the man off the floor and yelled, you think you have the power, I have the power.
Chris had a way about him when he would finally explode and go off into this, whatever you want to call him going into, his eyes would kind of bug out and he'd get red in the face and you could see blood veins and vessels on his head and he would just look like he's going to explode. and like he was gonna kill somebody. And he come up out of the seat like that, and his eyes were all budged out. And he grabbed the co-captain by the lapels of his jacket, and he just raised back and head-butted him right across here. And the blood just shot out of the co-captain's nose. And within a minute or two, his eyes were swollen.
And Kevin, who was a witness to all this, said it was just shocking. Nobody really disagreed as to the facts of what happened.
And a stewardess came and woke me up and asked me to come get my friend. And I went up there, and Chris had the guy in a, I think he had him a full Nelson or, no, he didn't. He had him in a, he was just in a choke.
And as fast as this started, it was over.
And so I hooked Chris and took him back to his seat. And I said, Chris, come on, man, get it together. You're gonna go to jail for this.
Nose is broke, teeth chipped. I said, they're gonna arrest you. He said, do you really think so? I said, yeah. And I said, the best thing for you to do would just be, just put your hands behind your back and let them handcuff you and go on, because I said, they're gonna take you if you want to or not. He said, ah, he says, they're not gonna do that. So him and Kevin Von Erich, they got started talking, and one of them come up with the idea that they would both go in the bathroom. Now, this is the craziest damn thing you've ever heard, and you're not going to believe this is true, but one of them come up with the idea that they would both go in the bathroom and change shirts. And when they changed shirts, then Chris would walk off, and they wouldn't know it was Chris. Like, there wasn't going to be no one there pointing, saying, that one.
I represented him in the very well-known case of the United States of America versus Chris Adams. He assaulted a co-pilot of an American Airlines flight that was up in the air flying over the ocean.
After the incident on the airline, Chris went to federal prison for 2 years.
For 6 months.
When he got out, he really tried to straighten his life out and put himself on a different path.
After the incident on the airplane, Chris did write us a letter, and he did tell us, it was a heartfelt letter, he did tell us that he was going to AA meetings, and that he was happy to do so, and that he was going to keep it up. Whether he kept it up or not, I don't know. But Chris was very spiritual, and he believed in lots of things. He wanted to do so much with his life, and he wanted to, to put the world at right and put himself at right. And I don't know, somehow, maybe he lost the battle, I don't know, but he really wanted to do that, because at heart he was a very good person.
He done had two kids that he didn't really get to know. He wanted to know Julia. He wanted to be a better father to Julia. And often when we was driving, he'd be reading something related to the baby's growth or the baby's emotional needs or how to be a better parent. And that's what he was looking for, is how to balance his professional life and his personal life. And it's a hard act to do when you can't walk into a Walmart's and pick up a pack of diapers without signing 20 autographs before you get to the checkout stand.
Are you ready? You ready?
Go.
You've gone through a lot over the years, and things are very different now.
Yeah, they're very different. Like I say, I realize what's important in my life, so I'm not whizzing around the world partying every night and ruining my relationship with my wife. And look at what? Oh, wow. Well, don't get too dirty. Huh? We'll brush it off. But it's real important to spend time with your children. I mean, it's part of you. And I think that my values in life have changed. And I would say over the last 10 years, I've learned an awful lot.
When Chris OD'd out in Wise County, he went to a psychiatrist, and the psychiatrist said that he was clinically depressed, and he had given him some antidepressants, and Chris just kept saying, I've got to do this for my daughter. I've got to do this for Julia.
Instead of looking upon money as being the most important thing, instead of looking upon being famous or being successful in my work, being successful in my personal life and being an icon to my children is much more important these days.
That is what he wanted to do. He was obviously struggling within himself. But the letter told us this, his phone calls told us this. He was fighting it quite well. We would like to have thought that, yes, he could have kept it up.
You know, I used to sort of have this repertoire where I would get up early in the morning. We would fly to our next venue, which could be LA, Chicago, New York, or wherever. We'd go book into a hotel, go to a gym, work out, and then rest a little. Then we'd wrestle, and then after we'd wrestle, we'd go and party, and then we'd do the same the next day, and then the same the next day, and the next day. And it became a way of life. It's a very destructive way of life.
But when he was drinking, his personality, you know, would change. And then he beat his wife up in Lufkin out there, you know, and knew about that too. It's all when he drank, he was never like that before. And then in Israel, he had stomped a desk clerk's face in really bad. He had to get craniofacial reconstructive surgery and all that, and all because he wouldn't let the Chris use the telephone anymore. And that was pretty bad. And there are just little things like that that I'd known about. He did in Japan, you know, he kind of did the same thing over there. Those little mafia guys, he beat a few of them up.
And people do get the wrong idea, like that we're girl chasing wrestling stars, or we're good time chasing wrestling stars or whatever. But like I say, over the last few years, a reality has set in, and I really believe that life is all about our children, it's all about our family, and doing them good and bringing them up in the right way, in the right direction. And that means much, much more to me these days than going out having a good time or going around chasing women.
His relationships seemed to go sour rather quickly, and a lot of his breakups weren't very pretty.
Let me see. Don't put you.
Ready?
Hi. There you go. Yeah. Okay. I think that's enough sand, don't you? You want to go in it more? Okay. Don't get it in your eye.
He was with Brandy at the time, and Chris hit her. And that night, as he drove out of the parking lot with her hanging from the side of the car, that was the night that I saw anger in Chris Adams that I had never seen directed toward any other person.
But my dad always played lots of games with me, and he did lots of puzzles too with me.
And I said, well, that's a place to start, but you've got to also think ahead, and you've got to do it for you. You know, you have to do it for you. He says, no, I've got to do it for Julia, because she can't keep seeing me like this when I'm getting pulled over and getting tickets and the cops are taking her out of the car from me because I'm getting DWIs.
She always seemed to be very happy and such a normal child for such a weird environment.
Well, my dad had this British accent that I really liked, and like, I know British too from him, and like, sometimes whenever he was telling me stuff in British, I'm always saying, why are you talking to me in British? And he just says, it's just from my country. That's British. My favorite thing about wrestling was my dad winning.
Do you love your dad winning?
Yes, I
do. Talk some about that. How you would feel?
Like, I just feel proud of my dad, and just whenever he won, and sometimes whenever he won the belt, I was like really proud of him because, I mean, he was really good.
And Kevin Von Erich hit from behind by Chris Adams. And having a chair in on Kevin Von Erich has gone absolutely crazy here, with Gary Hart now looking around, and he wants to get out of here.
Hello, everybody. This is Gentleman Chris Adams here again to give you another update on my own personalized coaching class. We're going to learn skill and speed training. It's important to do the things skillfully and at the right speed. Posture and charisma development. We'll cover physical appearance, conditioning and training, and nutrition information. We'll put you on your own course that lasts anything from 9 months to 2 years so that you can change your body in front of your very own eyes.
A lot of times, you can put your balance down on him like this. Lean forward so that he won't take you down, but he's already in a position for a powerbomb. So if like we're together, he goes for my legs. He's going for my neck. Now I've got him in the right position. Powerbomb.
Chad works out with you in your school, and you see things like this, and you say, guys, some guys are not thinking right in life, are they?
These are gang hieroglyphics, and I think...
probably drugs involved.
Yeah, really, and you can decide. I mean, you can decide at a young age. You have a goal. You know, my goal in life is to be up here and not always down here. And, you know, I'm hoping that what we're talking about right now will actually put people off doing this kind of stuff.
And drugs don't help you become successful.
Absolutely not.
The character that you choose should be an extension of your own personality. Take advantage of your own natural charisma and study similar characters to learn everything you can about them in order to grab the attention of the wrestling audience.
Steve Austin. And he's not backing up to anybody as he flips Terry Garvin around and gives him a look of disdain, I guess.
Yeah, Bill Mercer, he's a fine athlete. They do a lot of weightlifting. Him and the California Stud are pretty much inseparable, from what I understand. Fine athletes.
Steve ended up marrying Chris's ex, Jeannie.
Steve would not have got where he was now if it hadn't have been for Chris.
We do what we want to do, where we want to do it. If we want to come down here to Hooters and have a few beers, drink some chicken wings, well, that's what we're going to do, because no one tells us what to do.
What?
In the end, Chris was more known for the school that we created, where Stone Cold Steve Austin was discovered, than he was for wrestling. And I know that bothered Chris.
Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Right. Nice.
Now, how long did you, because he's with the WWF.
Right, he's with the WWF.
How long ago was it you started with him? Did you push him up?
Right. Well, he was with me for about 4 or 5 years. Yeah. And he was nothing. He came to the wrestling school, and step by step, he came up. And now he's one of the leading contenders for the WWF Heavyweight Championship.
And Steve and Jeannie had a couple kids. And because of the success, I believe Chris got very resentful. But I also know that Steve didn't like the way that Chris treated him. Kind of used him.
Chris showed him the ropes, came up with brilliant storyline, fed Steve his lines, had a hell of a match with him where Chris sold to really put Steve over.
When it came to business, Chris was pretty cold. And there was a lot of times I know Steve didn't get paid. He got paid very little.
And the problem with being in the position that we're in is that everybody wants to be your friend when you're on top.
We used to wrestle in the coolest places, in Africa and the Caribbean, you know, places that, you know, I always loved the water, swim. All my brothers did. But I used to really like it, especially like when the moon would come out, you know, like 2 or 3 in the morning sometimes, you know, when it wouldn't be dark. Because I'd like to be alone out there, you know, and I just love the ocean. And so one night I was swimming, it was really late. And I was coming in, I think it was about 3:30 in the morning. And I was coming into the lobby to get to my room, and there was Chris in a suit and all decked out, ready to the head out. He was had a hat on, a big long coat, you know, and a briefcase full of cash. I had it opened up and was getting some stuff out of it. And I said, Chris. And he whirled around and he said, oh, Kev. Hi, Kev. And I said, what are you doing, Chris? He goes, it's not like it looks. It's not like it looks. And I couldn't put two and two together. I was thinking, what do you mean it's not like it looks? And then it dawned on me, he was leaving with all the cash. So I said, well, Chris, you've got to pay my brother and you got to pay me. You can't leave this town without paying the boys, Chris. So I got my brother's money and he got mine, but he did leave the town and stiffed the boys.
I contacted Chris a couple of times and asked him if he'd be interested in moving his operation to the Carolinas because I believe he would have been perfect for that time period in the Carolinas. But Chris had decided he wanted to be an independent wrestling promoter. And I'm telling you, the hardest job in the world is to be an independent wrestling promoter. But think of this, Chris was a successful independent wrestling promoter for 10 years. We got involved several times trying to do a television series. Chris seemed more interested in TNA and girls than he did the talent on the card.
Mate, can you be a bit more of a, hey, this is Dr. Rock here. Okay. Yeah, more of a character.
Yeah.
After I know the parts, what I'm gonna say a few more times, the character will come out. Hi, Dr. Rock here again with you. There are hackers, and there are beautiful hackers.
I'm a beautiful hacker.
Yes, they are. Hacking, what does it mean?
We had a big uplifting feeling about it because Chris was already a celebrity, whether a local celebrity, shooting up to the national rise of celebrity. He was a very influential person, and it made us feel good that he was a part of this, that we were a part of what he was trying to make happen, the creative mind that he had. We had segments filmed for this show, but all the money from the guy that was funding the show spent all the money on a stripper named Lori.
Mike had the money. Okay, I didn't know he was married then. But I didn't know all that was really his wife's money too. But it turns out I introduced him for business purposes only, and Brandy was my best friend, and so, you know, I thought Mike's girlfriend.
He thought that was the way to success. Television show for Texas, he wanted to recapture world class. Well, we made a hell of an effort. We never got there because Chris just didn't have enough time left.
Chris couldn't just have one drink. He had to drink till it was all gone. If it was a bottle of whiskey, if it was a case of beer. He did everything to the extreme.
He just went all out on everything he did, whether it was wrestling, partying, whatever he did. He didn't stop low level. He went all the way to the top.
If anyone has experienced the depth of cocaine, is not good. Okay, and it messed me up.
Several of the other people in the show all developed alcohol and sometimes drug addiction. It went from the top. They either committed suicide early on, or in Chris's case, it was a long drawn out process of going down the tubes. I had myself a problem with alcohol, and I found a 12-step program, and it's definitely one day at a time. Chris used willpower. He was an extremely strong person. He set his mind to something, he was going to do it. The problem with alcohol and drugs is willpower is meaningless.
I always saw Chris as like the old pictures of George Reeves as Superman, but everything in Chris's life was kryptonite.
And then I found out Chris had told me he started trying a drug called GHB.
as he now returns, comes up and does a tremendous recovery, flipping the champion Rick Rude across the ring. The super kick by Chris Adams. Certainly no Sylvan in the woods of professional wrestling as he fires across now with a 1, 2.
The fact that Chris had a history of addiction with alcoholism, with any kind of drug issues, getting involved with GHB is guaranteed to make you what we call a G-aholic. With G in the clubs, in the strip joints, and then this whole dietary supplement aspect of it, we've seen so many of these guys that they end up dying or they end up killing somebody by accident.
You could buy it over the counter. He said some bodybuilders and some other wrestlers introduced it to him. And then it started being used for other reasons and became a pretty substantial problem with Chris. It grabbed a pretty good hold of him, along with the alcohol.
Boo Ray did all the driving, and Chris didn't have to maintain any humanity to be able to lay in the seat next to him asleep till they got to a show.
They have this thing where they do some kind of a sprinkle, sprinkle, and I thought they were just kidding around when they were sprinkle, sprinkling Xanax and Valium. And I was like, and Boo Ray, sprinkle, sprinkle, 10 volumes, boom, down, no problem.
The whole problem with GHB actually started in the mid-80s when bodybuilders were looking for alternatives to steroids, thinking that, you know, because steroids were being made illegal. They found GHB and they heard that it, when you go to sleep on it, it enhances your growth hormone production and it causes a tiny spike in growth hormone production. It's not anabolic because it doesn't stay, but they felt they were benefiting from it. And this is how the whole thing started. So for the most part, most of the addicts that we deal with, most of them, and many of the, those who just abuse it in general, were told it's a health food tonic, it's a dietary supplement, it's a sleep aid, it's a workout aid, it improves your sex life.
He was trying to convince me that it was okay to, you know, yeah, it might have been okay when it was at GNC, but it's not okay now, Chris. Yeah, he loved it. He loved it.
He'd overdose on it, and the lady that was with him called 911. They took him to Decatur. Well, once he finally came to, he had no wire, tubes in his nose and in his mouth. He yanked them out, got up, got dressed, and left the hospital.
One of the appealing things to GHB is that the effects only last 4 hours. And in fact, some people are almost frightened by the way that you can wake up so abruptly at the end of the 4 hour point. So in overdose cases, sometimes you'll see somebody who's completely comatose, as Chris was, I understand, in the hospital at one point, and yet they can set up at the 4 hour point as though nothing happened.
All right, I remember when Chris started this thing called shoot wrestling, where he would use actual wrestlers, and they would wear hand gear, head gear, and it was like ultimate fighting.
Chris Adams, this is what you gave me in the Ultimate Fight Challenge in Oklahoma at Hugo Agriplex. Let me tell you something. You don't do this to L.A. Steel, boy, and get away with it. There will be another time, and there will be another event.
We had a saying, Chris and I. We had three stages of a match. The first stage was I was going to rip his head off when I went into that match. And when the crowd got to the point to where I seen that they were going blitzing and crazy out on the floor, that's when we was getting pretty close to the mid of the match, and I would throw him to the floor.
And then I'd get him.
And then Lacey would get him,
and
then
the crowd
would go wild again.
Whip him, whip him, whip him.
Chris knew how to reach out there and just grab that crowd. And the way that he would do that was, I would climb out of the ring. By the time I hit the floor, he was already on top of me, beating me down out there, throwing me back into the ring, and we had the crowd going crazy.
this Beyond the Mat movie come out, and it showed about 3 seconds of Lacey in the main part of the movie. Then it showed all the credits, and then after that, it showed about another 15 minutes, and it showed Lacey and the girl she was going to wrestle.
When Chris felt so enraged about the film Beyond the Mat, he sent me an email saying that he felt like he was nothing but an extra, and he hated the film. And I sent him an email back, and I said, well, to me and my husband, this is the biggest thing that's ever happened to us. It enraged Chris even more. He made it his business to cut our legs out right from under us, where wrestling was concerned.
And the reason that I had to get rid of her and Billy was they kept calling me up and harassing me about an autograph party. And nobody wanted, Jake the Snake did not want to go. The midgets, what are we going to do, fly them in from Kansas?
We couldn't get booked by anybody. And Chris would just laugh. He thought it was a big joke because he would call everybody and make sure that nobody would book us.
Nobody that was in it wanted anything to do with it. It was just a thing that they were trying to be stars. And it took away their stardom when I had to fire them.
Chris Adams coming up to do battle. Kevin Von Erich is still down and out on the floor. Kevin is down by the corner post on his, trying to get to his feet. And it looks like they're going to have to take Kevin out. Gary catapulted into that clothesline by Chris Adams. They're taking Kevin Von Erich out of the arena. Here's Judo on Gary. Chris Adams and Judo on Andy. Came back furious, wound up, a wild man. He and Judo. And the corner post. There goes Chris Adams out. Kevin Von Erich, absolutely a wild man as he came roaring back to the ring. And Judo and Chris have left the ring.
Chris fell in love with a beautiful blonde-headed girl by the name of Linda Compense. He brought her up and introduced her to me, and I could tell in his eyes that this could possibly be the thing that straightened Chris out.
Linda was a very beautiful lady that Chris fell madly in love with. He called me and talked to me about her every day. I remember he was making plans to take Linda to England to meet his parents. They were going to move in together. I mean, that's all he talked about. It was the happiest I'd seen Chris in many years when he was with Linda.
I knew Linda mainly from junior high, and she was a cheerleader, very beautiful. One of the best looking girls in school, always had a smile on her face.
Linda was a very good girl, a good human being, always had a smile on her face.
Shortly after high school, some friends of mine that had known her, I guess dated her for a little while off and on, they found out she was working at a strip club.
Knowing that Chris hung out at strip clubs or had a history with strip clubs, it really fits in with the GHB because it's used by strippers themselves. If they're not really comfortable doing what they do, it's just what they have to do for a job, they'll get into GHB. They may use it even to drug some of their customers in order to get them to spend more money.
Very nice lady, very polite. I never heard her say a cuss word. And in the wrestling business, believe me, that's about all you ever do here. And she was just like a breath of fresh air. Knowing how Chris was when he drank and knowing that Chris was doing a drug called GHB and had already, in fact, overdosed at one point, I didn't see what she saw in Chris. I thought she could do much better, but I think she, like everybody else, was starstruck.
I don't know very many dancers who aren't at least familiar with it. Even in one case that I'm dealing with, it involves strip clubs. Even though they deny any knowledge of GHB in that club, the dancers do. Some of them did admit that they knew what it was and that they watched their drinks because they're worried about somebody drugging them.
He and Linda called me at 2 o'clock in the morning on the dot. They'd been at Clicks drinking Long Island teas and playing pool. They were wanting to come over. I stayed up with them. I had a glass of wine with them. And I said, look, guys, you know, y'all have a good time. I'm throwing in the towel. And the silence woke me up. Chris was in the living room, and he was slumped over a chair. He had his arm around the chair, but he was just out. And Linda was laying on her back, out. But not being a doctor or a physician or anything in the medical profession, I just thought they were drunk. And neither one of them would budge. But I've seen people drinking alcohol that was the same way. You couldn't wake them up. And I said, well, I'll sit here and watch and see, you know, if there's going to be a problem. And there was a problem. I didn't realize that Chris had GHB in the apartment. I called Tom Lance.
So he called me because he knew about a month prior that Chris about OD'd on the GHB, and I went out to the hospital that night, and he knew I kind of knew about the situation.
Because I started getting suspicious.
He knew Chris would be mad if he called the authorities or anything like that. But while I was on the phone with him, I could hear Linda's strange breathing, and then he just kept trying to wake him up, and finally I encouraged Bure to call 911, in which he did.
The lady asked me if I knew CPR.
And he sat there and he did CPR on Linda for over 20 minutes. But from what I understand of GHB, one of the things it does when you take too much is it causes your throat to contract and close up.
I gave her CPR until the paramedics got there.
I was on the phone the entire time on the other end. This was probably a couple of hours. I remember vividly hearing the paramedics arrive at the apartment. I could tell it was a little bit of chaos. They were trying to wake up Linda. They were trying to wake up Chris. I could hear them back and forth. Occasionally, Bure would get on the phone. And I could hear the paramedics. I still hear it to this day. I hear them saying, when they were working on Linda, flatline.
I wish I'd have called 911 center. They tried to give her CPR for another 20 minutes.
A little bit later, Bure called me, told me the police come back and said that Linda had made it, and that they thanked him for calling. And so at that point, we thought everything was fine. And then the next day, I got a call. I can't remember if it was Chris or if it was Bure saying that Linda was brain dead.
Chris called me at 1 o'clock that afternoon, asked me to come pick him up. I came and picked him up. Well, that's when he admitted to Linda's family that they had done GHB.
And I remember Chris telling me how he went to go see her in the hospital. Her family was pretty unkind to him. He had to leave. And then I remember when he found out they made a decision to go ahead and unplug Linda. she passed at that point.
They didn't have any charges on him. They checked their blood alcohol content, which I'm sure was very high. And but they had no traces of any other foul doings. So, but then there were other people that started keeping this thing going.
We're standing in front of the apartment number 5302 on the third floor, where Bure and Chris shared this apartment the fatal night where Linda Kafensk died.
When the accident happened with Linda, that's when everything went to hell in a handbag.
I'd never met this woman. I'd never even seen this woman. But with all the circumstances that I became aware of, I got on my computer and I made it my business to find this woman's family. I went to one message board. It was Texas.com, and that's where I posted it, because that was the main message board that everybody from independent wrestling shows went to back then. And that's where I posted it, that this Linda Kafensk had died by ingesting GHB given by Chris Adams. Their response to my post, "I can't believe that you're saying this, that he murdered her."
Chris was surrounded by people that were destructive in his life. These type of people gravitate to stars, and they supply drugs, they supply alcohol, they supply prostitutes.
One of the trappings of any type of entertainment, I mean, I do music, I did some wrestling with Chris, but you know, alcohol and drugs are made very readily available, and that's probably going to make several people in the entertainment industry, oh well, it's true people. When you're constantly putting these substances in yourself, you know, you're gonna do crazy, stupid things.
John worked his way into the dressing room by supplying illegal substances. That's the way he endeared himself and got to hang around.
I got a call from a good friend of mine who was a drug counselor, telling me there were some problems going on with Chris, and it took me a couple of days to actually reach him, and when I finally reached him, I could tell his mental state was very bad.
Some people called in, the authorities, and I remember they come and picked Chris up. And they took him to like a rehab type place here in Dallas, because some people were concerned about Chris being suicidal, hurting himself. I remember going and seeing him there. And then I remember when Chris got out, he went to Florida for a little bit, him and Julia.
And he came to live with my ex-wife, Samantha, and myself in Florida for about 4 months. And during that time, there were a lot of ups and downs. The first couple of months, you know, and again, it's an addiction. Chris wanted to drink and self-medicate to mask those problems. But when he would sober up and clear up, you know, there was a real heart there. And his heart was broken over what had happened. He didn't know how to really handle life anymore. know, we knew the situation and some of the people that liked to associate around Chris because of who he was, not because, and I'll be blunt, not because they gave a damn, but they wanted to hang out with somebody because they were a celebrity.
He got a limo about a year ago. Weimer was in town, or John Raven. He had my driver following him in like a bodyguard, you know, like he needed one.
Obviously, he was extremely emotional, and he phoned me up a lot. I talked to him as best I could. I wasn't in the same city as him. I said, listen, Chris, you know, I'm willing to pay for you to go into the rehab. Please, would you go? I don't know if he even heard me properly because of his tears and his emotional demeanor. He was so distraught.
Me and Leanne were going to Lacey's for a visit, and my kids were home, and my kids would stand around the answering machine like in a screening process, and the phone rang, and it was Chris, and Chris was just screaming, Pam, you disgusting, nasty, fat, stinking cunt. I mean, it was just horrible words like that. You know, you've messed in my business one time too many. You keep poking your nose in my business. You keep messing with me. I have told you not to mess with me. I warned you. Now, if you don't stay out of my business and quit messing with me, you're going to end up just like Linda. And it terrified my children. It scared them, and they immediately picked up the phone and called me on my cell phone and told me what had happened, played the message for me, and it scared me. I was afraid. And I went on to Lacey's.
I said, Pam, you have got to bring that recording forward. I contacted the homicide detective, Detective Symington, myself, and I told him that there is a recording where he is threatening another woman to kill her the same way that Linda died. And this detective became very interested in this recording.
The Collin County District Attorney's Office received a case file report from Richardson Police Department. The grand jury prosecutor reviews the case and submits it to the grand jury, and Mr. Chris Adams was indicted on one count of manslaughter.
That one tape is basically what really hung Chris Adams.
Chris wanted to kill Lacey. Yes, he did. And he had talked to a hitman about having it done. And the hitman wouldn't have any part of it because he knew the situation, that somebody would have, spilled the beans, and he would have gotten a lot of trouble. But I didn't want any part of any of it. And I told Chris a bunch of times, I said, look, Chris, you do something crazy like that, they're gonna come to three people, us three, you know? And, but he said, I don't give a damn, I want her dead.
Okay, I'm going to unload a bombshell on you. Okay, Chris contacted a hitman to kill you.
Oh, really?
I'm glad, in the spirit, I'm glad you're here because you're going to pray more people in like you in this church. I know folk don't really see it, but I'm telling you, there's an anointing in this church that's fixing to explode this ministry wide open. Stand right here. Lift your hands up. Put it on him like they used to.
Shortly after Linda's death, he met a girl by the name of Karen, a legal secretary,
that fell madly in love with Chris. And knowing that Chris had all these legal problems and these drug problems, it didn't prevent Karen from marrying him.
Will you have this woman to be thy lawful wedded wife?
Let's see, we met in November of 2000, and we got married in August of 2001. We both knew right away that we were soulmates. Just, I'd never had felt that before, to have that true gut, heart, soul feeling for somebody and know that that person felt the same. So he calls me the day of the wedding, and he says, do you trust me? And I said, well, yeah, I trust you. And he said, well, you trust me to go to a costume store and rent you a dress to match with my Doc Holliday outfit?
Doc Holliday was Chris's favorite outlaw. He loved Westerns. He loved American way of life. Doc Holliday was his hero. It was something Chris wanted to be, that Chris was.
This ring is applied. This man's finger. This man belongs.
Chris was just ecstatic. And finally he said, don't you want to see him? And, you know, I'm going, what? And he said, the wedding pictures. You know, he was proud of being married. He was happier than I've seen him in a long time.
We had so much in common. We had the same dreams, the same goals, and we just, both free spirits, we both just related so well on many things.
She had two lovely children. She has a daughter and a little boy, and Chris loved them both, and he became a father to them.
He was disgusting whenever he wanted to be, just for a laugh. He'd eat paintballs, he'd do stuff just to gross everybody out. He was a great guy, he really was.
So many people, when they talk about Chris, they want to talk about all the negative things in his life. And if people could have seen him at the end of his life, he was such a different person from that. I never really saw that negative side of him.
When I first met Chris, I thought he was a very nice, kind, gentlemanly person. I really did. And I was never so shocked in all of my life as I was one night. They were over here, he and Karen, and I heard him talking so ugly to that girl. And he called her some ugly names that I really don't care to repeat, but I can if it's necessary. He was threatening Karen and calling her names and wanting her to leave. And I told him, I told Karen, honey, if you don't get Chris out of here, I'm going to have to call the police. Well, after that, he went on with Karen. But then on the way home, they had to do some drinking. I think they had wine in the car. They were arrested. And they were arrested on the way to their home after they had left here. They had gotten in a ditch or maybe they were just sitting arguing. I don't know what they did. They were arrested for public intoxication. Mm-hmm.
He was a beautiful person in and out from moment on that we met. He was always talking about wanting to change for the better, wanting to quit drinking and wanting to live right and just live for the family. And I saw more of that after he became a Christian.
Anybody ever used to watch wrestling? Put your hand up. If you ever... good night. It was almost half of everybody in here. Anybody ever heard of Gentleman Chris Adams? Okay. We were preaching a revival in Terrell, Texas at Pastor Harold's church, Harris's church. And he came that night. And God richly just moved all over that young man. He had never been in a Pentecostal church ever in his life. Matter of fact, he had never been in church at all. He didn't know anything about the Lord. And when he came into the building, I stepped off the platform and head down the aisle, and I told him, I said, you know, you have a profession of picking up bigger guys than me and throw them across the floor without even blinking your eye twice. I said, but I'm going to show you the power of God. And I reached my hand up towards him and just said, Jesus. And the power of God picked that man up and threw him at the wall. He got up and shook his head. He said, what was that? And I said, it was the love of God. And come on now.
Tommy Drum was a real strong influence on my life.
He came to the front and demons manifest. We cast devils out of him and God saved him. And we threw him back on the floor and God filled him with the Holy Ghost. And he spoke with tongues as the Spirit of God gave him the utterance.
He changed mine and Chris's life that night that we attended his church revival. I'll never forget it. There was such a presence there I had never felt.
I've seen a cancer the size of a grapefruit. It lodged in a woman's throat. And when the handkerchief was placed upon that woman's throat, and God opened up her skin, and that thing fell out of her skin in a bloody mass all over the handkerchief, and God healed that hoe up. I saw it.
He definitely wanted to just pull himself away from anything negative. And even his disgust about wanting to be away from the wrestling field.
He was coming to work for me. He was going to be outside sales with the limousine company over here.
We were talking about, you know, his charges and his lawyers and how much money he's paid. And what I said, listen, this is what we got to do. We had made plans. We were making plans, and we were actually going to go to AA together. And it was something that we decided that we needed to turn our will over to the power of God, our higher power.
Okay, for one thing, nobody would work him wrestling. The other thing was he owed the IRS in excess of $50,000 or $60,000. He owed Tony around $50,000 or $60,000.
He wasn't used to living in such quiet quarters. He'd call me every day. Especially when he wasn't working anymore. He'd call me every day, and I hate using this language, but he'd say, Tom, I feel like a house nigger. He says, all I do is clean house, stay in his house. And I know he stayed aggravated at the kids. His patience got real thin. And I know he started drinking again, pretty heavy at that time. And I know him and Boo Ray were good friends. They were hanging out a lot.
Boo Ray gave me some arrowheads.
Well, tell me about Boo Ray.
Well, he's kind of, sometimes he gets drunk.
He had faith that eventually, by living right and living under God's will, that his troubles would hopefully go away.
He was supposed to wrestle in Waxahachie for Tim Brooks, and because of the situation with Linda and the upcoming trial for manslaughter, the sponsors of the show didn't feel comfortable having Chris there.
It was just like any typical day. I got up and went into work, and Chris was home that day, and he was house cleaning as he normally did.
I talked to Chris probably about 11 in the morning, and he was in a very down mood.
And Killer called me on the phone. He said, the sponsor said they're going to back out if I use Chris Adams. He said, what do you think I should do? And I told Tim, I said, Chris will understand, but if you would, give Chris a call. And he called Chris and explained the situation, and Chris took it like a man.
He was bummed out about not being able to bring in any income. And that's where, you know, he'd called Agbar 3 days ahead and told about, you know, the demotion from being on top of the world to, you know, pretty much a house slave.
He was feeling really, really depressed. And I could feel, you know, there was something wrong. And he goes, hey, Lori, I need to borrow $20. I need to borrow $20. Can I come borrow $20? And it was so he could, you know, have gas to go and see his lawyer.
I remember getting a phone call from Brent, Chris's friend Brent, who we often referred to as Boo Ray. And he was really down that day. And he'd been down a lot lately. He had complain about wanting to end his life. And, you know, Chris and I had run to his aid before and went over to his house in Waxahachie to try to cheer him up. And on this particular day, I called Chris at home and said, Brent's down again. He's really depressed.
I was in kind of one of my down moods, but he was in a down mood. And I said, look, man, let's get together and work on this show. He said, well, Karen's going out tonight. You know, I don't know if it's a birthday party, but they just called it, he called it a girl's night out.
Yeah, we went to the country club up in Wiley. It was a private club and we had a drink. Well, you know, we had a good time.
He was complaining about Karen. I wonder what she's doing right now and things like that.
I talked to Chris six times, okay, since that morning, six times. All together.
I wanted to go with Chris out there, but he said, you know, I think I need to go. He's very upset.
Well, I couldn't provide $20 for him to borrow for gas so he could go see his lawyer and do what he's supposed to be doing to get himself where he needed to be and where he was very well on his way to be. He scraped, and this is exact words, he scraped $1.50 in change. He found, he even went looking in the sofa. You know, he's telling me all that. I mean, $1.50, guys, okay, he had to put in change in the gas tank. Well, next thing I know, $1.50 in change and gas went not to the lawyer's office, but to Boo Ray's house. He's gonna go get money from Boo Ray. Boo Ray just said, oh, come on over, I'll give you some money.
He said, I'll be over about 2 o'clock.
We kept waiting and waiting for him.
Well, he got to my house at probably 7:30.
I think it was around somewhere between 6 and 7 o'clock in the evening.
We were planning a show that we were gonna put on in Quitman, Texas.
And he and Brent had some business to take care of. And
we worked on that for, I don't know, I'd say, let's see, probably about 3 hours.
You know, we worked on it for an hour and a half, and then we just kind of said, hey, man, let's take a break.
Let's watch something. And he looks through, you know, my library of tapes, and he says, let's watch Frank and Jesse.
And I haven't watched the movie since. It's just like it was. But it was Frank and Jesse.
Chris Adams and Doc Holliday, Chris admired him. He was a gambler, a drinker, a womanizer. I think that's one of the few heroes that Chris had in his life. Doc Holliday died of tuberculosis. Chris was dying of loneliness. He is dying. Everything, he looked good to the outside. He had everything. Deep down inside, nobody knew the torment, the demons that tortured him during the night, the drink, the drugs, the women, the failed marriages, the failed relationships in between the marriages. But it got there at the end. I could tell that Chris was literally dying a little bit every day, just like Doc Holliday.
We were about 3/4 into it when it just seemed like the whole sky fell in on us.
Things was in so much turmoil for him in his last days. I mean, it was constant arguments with the promoters, the bad publicity he got in here locally. He knew he figured that he was going, and he just couldn't see himself wasting away in jail.
I remember everything about it except what provoked him, and I think what it was, you know, he wouldn't close the door. And my mother was in the next bedroom, and I got up and closed the door and said, Chris, we got to be quiet. You know, my mother's in there asleep. And then, boy, he just, I think that's what happened, but I can't think of anything else that I would have said to provoke him like that.
Karen had called and called and called. Chris, I said, Chris, call Karen back. Karen's calling me in tears. Chris isn't calling her back. Going to find out. Boo Ray and Chris are, you know, having their little idea of what Karen was to Chris or what have you. Boomer was being pretty blunt on saying whatever he thought Chris was being as far as using Perrin for, you know, just going where he shouldn't have gone, you know. And Chris wasn't using her for anything. Yes, she was making the money, but you don't take something like that and turn it around and not with, you just don't do that.
And that shouldn't have provoked him, but Chris, once he had a certain amount of alcohol in him, he really could, just go off at the drop of a hat or any word said. But anyway, right then, he started cussing at me and getting louder.
There was a phone call at midnight had come in. It was Brent's voice. And so many times when he and Chris were together, Boo Ray would call me and say, you know, just to say hi to me first and then hand the phone to Chris. And on this particular message, Boo Ray was highly intoxicated, more so than I ever remember him being, and saying something to me about Chris wanted to talk to me and please, you know, give him a call.
Hell yeah, he didn't trust her as far as he could throw her, but it was a place for him to live. And this is what he told me, but she had a great personality, and always was happy, but Chris said she's ditzy. I don't trust her. Oh, he's called her a cunt a few times, which that's the one word a woman does not like to hear.
And I missed that call. I didn't hear the phone ring, so I never got that message. And he was shot an hour later.
He pushed me, and I kind of went against this post and then went this way. And all this stuff wasn't here then. And he grabbed this post and just broke it off and started to swing. Well, I hit the post, getting it out of his hand, and my whole hand was black. Cracked my knuckle and my index finger, but I got the post from him, you know, this part. And then he attacked and grabbed me, and he put me in a sleeper, and we went this way. So the bookshelf wasn't there, of course, and we went through, we knocked out 5 or 6 window panes. We cracked into them, which put a pretty good little slice in my side. And then we somehow came back around this way. And he just overweighted me and pushed me back on the bed. And about like that. And he jumped on top of me and started trying to gouge my eyes out. And he bit me good on the face, and then he started choking on me.
And when he described what Chris was doing to him, I knew that he was trying to shut off his carotid artery and kill him. And it's no doubt about that. The carotid artery is right. That's what we use when we use the sleeper, you know. A sleeper is a hold we use to shut off either side of these two big veins that feed the brain.
And I was at a point that this is what's going to sound weird, but it's the truth. I swear on my daddy's grave. But his eyes were like glowing, seemed like the Exorcist.
Brent Parnell described Chris as having demon eyes, his eyes rolling back into his head. That's one of the descriptions that we often get. Sometimes of the overdose cases where they're out of control, but often in withdrawal too, they get this demonic expression. And if they do survive, if they don't die from it, they often don't recall any of what they've done. Certainly don't remember the events as dramatic and violent as they really were.
He had the strength of 3 Chris's, and always kept a pistol. Always kept a pistol on this end table. I grabbed this pistol. And I hit him about 3 times in the head to try to knock sense into him. And he just kept getting stronger. And I was at the point, I was just about to pass out. I mean, he had my air cut off. I couldn't breathe. And hell, I really couldn't. I mean, if I couldn't punch him with that pistol and knock sense into him, my fists wouldn't have been a bit of good. But he just kept getting stronger. And that's when I knew it was me or him. And I had no choice but to shoot him. And after I did that, I crawled out from under him and I went and I called 911 immediately. They talked to me on the phone and said the laws are on the way and ambulances. And I was at the door with the gun, handed him the gun butt forward.
This guy Parnell is—he's huge. He's like 250 pounds, and he's got a big scar on his face. But he's one of the nicest guys you'd ever meet. I mean, he's genuinely just a good old boy from Texas. He is one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet. And but he looks like the kind of a murderer because he's great big and he's got a scar on his face and all. And I could just see how this was going to look.
We discovered that the aunts were in the house at the time of the disturbance, and each aunt was in a different room. We was amazed that during the fight between Chris and Brent, that the aunts were never was disturbed out of the room. A matter of fact, I think the patrol officers said they had to go and get them up out of bed.
The lights were on in this house, and the police, the living room was full of police. And I thought, what in this world is going on?
It was awful weird that they didn't hear the gunshot. Found lots of prescription drugs. Valium, lots of painkillers, pain pills, Xanax.
Chris responded to things in a physical way. I guess we all do, we're athletes. And anyway, Chris, it was terrible to lose him, but it was also terrible to hear how it had happened. You see, this guy, Parnell, that killed him, had a settlement with an oil company. He'd always been kind of he wanted to be a wrestler for a long time, but he was a little old to start wrestling, you know, for one thing, and he was, and he'd had this broken hip, and it just wasn't going to happen for him. Well, a lot of the wrestlers just kind of ignored him. Well, once he got the settlement, he and Chris became good friends, you know. And Chris started, you know, borrowing money, and next thing you know, he's living with him, and it was just bad all around. But I know Chris pretty well, and. Man, I hated to see that.
Chris used Boo Ray as a chauffeur, as a confidant, and in the end, an angel of death.
Well, Karen and I's 3 hours of having a good time turned out to be hell. One of the officers said, I have some terrible news, and they broke the news. I mean, they told her, and, you know. It didn't sink in. I didn't believe it. And I was like this. I could not feel anything. I couldn't feel anything. Mentally, I was comforting Karen, but I wasn't hearing the actual reality of the whole reason why I was comforting her is because my best friend was just shot and he got killed, he died. We're not just gonna believe it.
A part of me really thinks Chris wanted that to happen. I don't know how to put that in words, but from my conversation with him, or my many conversations with him, he was pretty tired of being here on Earth.
Now that so much time has passed and I've had so much time
to rethink about what has happened. I really regret the way that I pursued and the way that I went after Chris because of my anger that I directed towards him, and it shouldn't have been directed towards him. Chris was a good person. Chris was good to me. And there were outside influences that were influencing Chris and that caused the hostile problems that he and I were having. And just the things, I just really regret doing what I did, speaking with the detective. And I just really regret it because I don't believe that Chris intentionally would murder a woman that he was dating.
The odd thing is it was 7 miles from the arena, just 7 miles down the road from the arena. And it really rocked my world. I truly loved Chris. Still bothers me. I just wish he was here.
And yeah, I miss him a lot.
And now the electric scissors, administered by Kerry Von Erich. And there goes the handsome young man from England's here, Chris Adams, going ball right here in the ring on the floor of the Cotton Bowl. Head cheering.
And look at the points that I'd like you to remember about eating right, training right, looking right. Regular workouts, plenty of rest, correct diet, and the avoidance of all drugs.
I haven't danced in about 3.5 years, and I haven't drank alcohol, and I feel really, really healthy.